that if the truth be told, I'm already all right. Knowing that I'm in Christ and that Christ has the whole battle already settled. Amen. We thank the choir for leading us in this ministry of music. As the late Reverend S. McIntyre would say, we don't have to invite him in because he's already here. Amen. To our worship leader of the afternoon, the pastor of the Jerusalem Baptist Church, Reverend Beotis Clark, who has led us very ably through this anniversary of this great pastor and wife. To our honorees, Reverend Moffitt and his wife, let me thank you for sharing this preaching place with me and asking us to come over and share with you in this fifth pastoral appreciation. When I first started some years ago getting emails from this Reverend M, I was wondering who in the world was Reverend M. I didn't know Reverend M. Amen. So I had to finish reading to find out who. See, when he got over here, he changed his name. Amen. To Reverend M. See, when I knew him, you were just Jeff Moffitt. So we're just happy. I'm just happy to know him. And then to be able to see the growth that God has allowed him to obtain and where God has taken him thus far. And there's no telling where God is going to continue to take him as he continues to keep his hands in the Lord's hand. To the officers, members, and friends of this church and to all of these ministers of the gospel, to each of you, it's just good to be here. And for a few moments, if you will, look with me to the gospel that is recorded by Matthew. Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. Very familiar passage of scripture beginning at verse 1. Matthew chapter 4 beginning at verse 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. When he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterwards and hunger. When the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. For a few moments, I just want to talk about the kind of man you have. The kind of man that you have. Let me thank Deacon Reed for his very kind introduction this afternoon as well. The kind of man that you have. When you look at this gospel that is recorded by Matthew and the passage that was just read, we must realize that it is not Matthew's gospel, but that Matthew only served as the secretary for the Holy Spirit to write what was divinely inspired unto him. When you look at this gospel that is recorded by Matthew, you must look at the man himself, because when you look at Matthew, he was a publican, he was a tax collector. Matthew had a position with the Roman government collecting taxes from the Jews. Now, that is tantamount to a person of ebony hue being a member of the Ku Klux Klan. Here Matthew is. He's a Jew, and he is collecting taxes for a Roman Gentile government. And just when Matthew wrote this gospel, we don't know, but some theologians believe that Matthew would often leave his office go down and listen to Jesus doing some teaching. But we do know that one day Jesus passed by the place where Matthew worked. And while Matthew was there at the seat of customs and collecting taxes, the Bible said, Jesus just said, follow me. And I like what happened, because without hesitation, Matthew arose and followed Jesus. And because of that wise decision that he made then, he became one of the writers of the four gospels. The subject of the gospel of Matthew is the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. It addresses the Jews in an attempt to prove to the Jews that Jesus is the expected Messiah. It does so by showing that Jesus is the son of David and he is the seed of Abraham. The Bible lets us know when we start in Matthew chapter 4 that Jesus had just started out on his public ministry. He had come down from the village of Nazareth in Galilee down to the Jordan River. And when he got to the Jordan River, he submitted himself to the baptism at the hand of one by the name of John the Baptist. You recall from Bible reading, those of you who are Sunday school students and Bible study students, you remember a long time ago, back in the Old Testament, when Abraham and Isaac had gone up on the mountain and Isaac asked his daddy, Daddy, where is the lamb? Well, John answers that question when he sees Jesus walking down to the Jordan River, and John looks up and John says, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Wow, when Jesus got in the water, the Bible lets me know that all three persons of the Godhead was present at the same time. That you had Jesus Christ in the water. You had the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove descending from heaven and lighting on the shoulders of Jesus Christ. And you had God himself up in heaven. God got on heaven's PA system and said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. And no sooner had Jesus been baptized and had come out of the water, the Bible said he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Now, while he's in the wilderness, the Bible said that he was led there to be tempted, to be tested, to be tried by the devil. And he went 40 days and he went 40 nights without food. And you can imagine, 40 days and 40 nights without food, Jesus was hungry. We don't even have to go 40 days. We can go a couple of hours and we are hungry. But Jesus, I can imagine somebody now is saying, yeah, here we've been finished, because we want to go to the annex across the street and we just had breakfast 40 days. And 40 nights, Jesus had been out there in the wilderness. He had been fasting. He had been praying. He had been communicating with God the Father. And afterwards, he was hungry. And lo and behold, the tempter came to him. And the tempter says to him, if you are who you say you are, if you are the Son of God, if you are this Jesus that you claim to be, command that these stones here be turned into loaves of bread. Notice now, Jesus was tempted. But we got some super saints today. We have some fire baptized and Holy Ghost filled saints today that have never been tempted. I know they're not up here. I know they're not in Harrisburg. But Reverend Mark, we got some saints that love the Lord and that they're on their way to heaven anyhow. But they don't know what temptation is. But I got to confess. I must. I hope you'll allow me to come back. But I got to confess. I have.
Yes,
If the truth be known, all us folks, all of us in here have had at least one temptation. And can I even push it further? Not only have we been tempted, but we have yielded to some temptation. I ain't talking about before you got saved. No, I'm talking about since you've been singing in the choir. But I like what the writer said, yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. And if we win one victory, then there's a possibility we can win another victory. The devil, my brothers and sisters, he is on his job. And it's his job to try to get those of us who know the Lord to sin. It is right here in the text. The devil goes up to Jesus, says, command that these stones be made into loaves of bread. And I want y'all to know, I looked at the Apostle Paul one day, and Paul said, y'all know what? I even had some temptation. Paul said, when I would do right, when I would do good. Is all around me. Okay, I want anybody here ever struggling with sin? Anybody ever struggling with some temptations in your life? The devil said, if you are the Son of God, if you are who you claim to be, command that these stones be made in the bread. But Jesus looked at it. And Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone. Well then, if man does not live by bread alone, what kind of man is it then that we have here? Well, yeah. What does Reverend M live by? The Living Bible. The Living Bible paraphrase said, no, for the scripture tells us that bread won't feed men. So you see, a man can be filled with bread.
which is called the staff of life, and still be perishing from spiritual malnutrition. There's an emptiness in the heart of man that only God himself can fill. And we have tried to fill the vacuums in our life with man-made bread. We tried every method at our disposal to fill this vacuum. Some people have even tried money. There are those in this world who believe that money is the answer to all things. That if they just had a substantial amount of money, everything would be all right. I've seen on the news where individuals have won the lottery, but then they had plenty of money. They had a thing not too long ago of a woman who had won over $10 million, and within 10 years, she was broke. All I'm trying to tell you, money is not the answer, because you can have money and still be messed up. And it really doesn't matter how much you make, because you can make $1 million and spend one penny over and you still broke. All I'm trying to tell you, you money is not the answer. People have lived long enough to learn that money is not the answer. I dare you to call the roll. Well, thank you, because there was a man in the Bible that is affectionately known as Diabetes, and you recall that he was a rich man, had everything that he wanted, but the Bible said he died and went to hell. Y'all do know there was a rich young ruler. He had everything that he wanted, and Jesus says to him, go and sell what you have and give it to the poor. Y'all remember there was another man. He was a rich farmer, and the Bible said he had a bumper crop. And then he sat back in his lazy boy, had his remote control in his hand. He was going through channel surfing on his television when there was a knock at his door, and he got the word, food this night. Your soul gonna be required of thee. All I'm trying to let you know is money is not the answer. But then there are others in our society who think that all that they need are some things. If I can get the Mercedes, if I can get the Lexus, if I can get the BMW, if I can get the split level, if I can get the ranch stock, if I can get the right kind of clothing, if I get the recognition, if I get prestige, well, when all that is gone, you understand Jesus. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Well, Lord, tell me, what does my live by? Well, first of all, he lives by faith. Yes. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I like what the Living New Testament said. You can never please God without faith, without depending on him. And anyone who want to come to God must believe that there is a God. That he rewards those who sincerely look for him. Well, what is faith? Faith says, the writer of Hebrews, is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. What is faith? Well, faith is the confident assurance that something that we want is going to happen. It is the certainty that what we hope for is waiting for us. Even though I can't see it, I got faith. Yes. My prophet has some faith, y'all. Because you see, faith is believing what you can't see. Faith is knowing where you can't go. Faith is acting on trusting God out of sight. And in a world, in a world where crime is on the increase, in a world where people want to hear strange doctrine, in a world where people want sermons that tickle their ears, in a world like this, we need something that has great faith. We need someone who can stand. A world like this, we need the kind of faith to take God Abraham was the father of the faithful, and the Bible said that he was a friend of God. The Bible lets me know that Abraham believed God, and it was counted for him towards righteousness. And there comes a time in all of our life when our faith will be tested. Yeah, Prophet, I'm sure in 5 years since you've been over here, your faith has been tested. I heard somebody say it earlier, and I'm going to just paraphrase. It hadn't always been good days. It hadn't always been flowery beds of Eden. No, no. There have been some days over here where faith has been tested. Abraham's faith was tested. Y'all know what happened to Abraham, because God called Abraham one day and God said, now take your boy Isaac. Yeah. Now you know Abraham must have had a problem with God. Yeah. Take your boy Isaac. Now this child was born to Abraham and his wife when they were old. They were past childbearing age. And God had not looked like to me. God is being look like to me, God is being terrible towards Abraham. You're going to give me this child. And then you're going to tell me to go and take this child's life. God, don't you know my wife is going to be upset? Because this boy is the apple of her eye. This boy, she has waited for him to go kill. God said, yes. Just do what I tell you. But now this is where the faith comes in, y'all, because Abraham and Isaac and the servants, they are now on their way down to the land of Moriah in order to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. But look at it. He is obedient. When he gets to the land of Moriah, Abraham says to the servant, and here's the faith, y'all wait here. All right. The boy and I, we're going to the mountain, but we shall return. Got to the top of the mountain, the altar was prepared. Abraham was proceeding with the sacrifice. He bound Isaac up, put him on the altar, reached for his knife, about to take his life, but an angel came out, and God commanded Abraham to stay his hand. Look behind you, I got a lamb already caught up in the thicket. Abraham named that place Jehovah Jireh. When you got the kind of faith that Abraham have, you know that God provide. And I'm wondering this afternoon, is there anybody in Hosanna that knows God will provide? I know the pastor know that God will provide, but do you know? And has God ever provided anything for you when you were at your wit's end, when you didn't know how you were going to make it? God! And can I tell you, God will even use your enemies sometimes in order to provide for you. I tell you, God will use your enemies in order to give a blessing to you. So instead of cursing your enemies out, you ought to thank them every now and then, because you got some blessings just because they were your enemies. Because God said, I'm going to prepare a table for you. And the very presence of your enemy, you down for the count. They think that you are out, but God said, I'm going to show them something. I'm going to bless you even in the midst of all of them. And We always pray and ask the Lord, give me a little more patience. But I stop by to tell you, when you ask God for patience, you ask God, send me some more trouble. You ask God to send me some more trials and tribulations, because the Bible said tribulation working patience. That lets me know I got to have some calm enduring. I got to be calm without complaining. I got to be calm without losing self-control. Patience is a virtue. The Apostle Paul, over in Romans chapter 5, he mentions patience. He said, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this great glory wherein we stand. And Paul said that we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we glory in tribulation, knowing also that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Yes, and one of the lessons that we can learn is how to wait on God. I heard in the reflections how when Reverend Bean said, I got the person for you, but he ain't here yet. Y'all have to wait on God. And Jeremiah said that God will give us pastors after his own heart. You have to wait till he got back in order for God to send you who God wanted you to have. The Bible tells me over in Isaiah, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings. They'll run and not get weary. They'll walk and not faint. One of the greatest examples of patience that I can see in the Bible is a man by the name of Job. Y'all know Job. Job became a subject of controversy between God and Satan. Satan told God that Job was serving him because God was blessing him. But then God granted the devil permission to touch Job's surrounding. And when he did, Job lost all of his sheep. If you look at the book of Job, you will see that he lost all of his camels, his donkey, and his cattle. You will realize that Job even had 10 funerals in one day. But the Bible said Job just simply bowed down to the earth, rending his clothes, and said, naked came out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. Job just said, the Lord give it, and the Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But I stop by to tell you, you got to do a whole lot more waiting. You got to have a whole lot more patience. Because you get rid of the devil on one hand, don't think that you're through with the devil or the other hand. Because what Satan did, he went back to regather himself and came back to attack Job one more time. And when he came back this time, Mother, he came back and touched the body of Job. And the Bible tells me that Job broke out in sore from the crown of his head down to the sole of his feet. And I don't know about you, but I can see Job right now. He is in some excruciating pain. I can see Job right now. I can see the pause that is on his body from the sole of his feet to the crown of his head. Now I can see every now and then one of those sores opening up, and I can see pus running out. Every now and then I can look at the body of Job, and I see a little blood and a little yellow pus coming out of Job's body. And then I'm catching an odor now, because those sores open eyes. But see, when they open up their mouths, they don't even say the right thing. And then he got a wife that loves him, and she tells him, honey, why don't you curse God and die? But Job had some patience, and the reason I know he had patience is because he said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him.
Going on.
pronounced